So now I'd like to introduce our first speaker, who is Dr. Dita Bisheva. So I will pass it over to Dita, and you've got your lapel mic, great. Yep,
thank you very much. My research focuses on using optics for medical applications, and as you probably all know, any disease that develops in the human body results in changes in the structure of biological tissue, physiology of the tissue, metabolic processes, and can affect also blood flow. So measuring those changes provides markers to clinicians based on which they can provide a diagnosis or they can monitor treatment of a particular disease. Now, in my research and also looking at experience with other colleagues, whenever we communicate with physicians and we ask them what would be the ideal new technology that can help you with the diagnostic of a disease, they typically come with a long list of requirements. And on the list you can find things such as you want non-contact and non-invasive imaging. You don't want to damage the tissue. You don't want to cause patients any kind of pain or discomfort. You want to be able to image the entire human body, large sections of it, for example, the brain, the lungs, and so on. But you want an imaging instrument that can also have the resolution to zoom in and be able to recognize structural changes on a cellular level or even subcellular level. You want to be able to display the images, even three-dimensional ones, very fast, in real time on the screen, and on occasion to have the technology in such a miniature state that you can actually send the patient home with a small device, and then monitoring the condition of the patient can provide data that is wired wirelessly to a distant location where it's pre-processed and then delivered to the doctor. And finally, on this long list of requirements, we also have the low cost. And if you look at this list, some of the requirements are quite contradictory. So if I ask you, does any device that currently exists on the market comply with every single requirement on the list, the answer will be no, right? Have we imagined a device like this? I know of one, so people that watch Star Trek, a little bit older than generation like me, you know of this device called the medical tricorder, which is pretty much the size of a phone. You can wave it at a subject, and you can get all the diagnostic information that you need, and you get it again wirelessly, very compact, to the point where you can make a diagnosis. So this is the future. That's where we are heading. But different research groups and different companies are tackling items on this list differently into different stages. So my lab focuses on using optical ways to image biological tissue fast with very high resolution. So we do answer some of the requirements here, but not all on the list. Why do we choose optics? Optical waves have a wavelength which is between 0.1 and 1 micron for visible radiation. So we talk about from UV to near infrared. And any kind of imaging instrument that is based on optics is going to have a resolution limit that is about the size of the wavelength. Because of that, comparing the size of cells or other organelles in tissue, we can comfortably get to a resolution where we can image groups of cells, individual cells, or even go within the cell. So for that reason, this is the first reason why we use optics. The second one is, if we use low-power optical radiation, we can provide a non-invasive imaging, non-contact imaging. We don't damage the tissue. But if you wanted to use the light for therapeutic purposes, we can crank up the power and we can cut tissue, so we can use a surgical scalpel, which is laser-based. We can weld tissue instead of sewing it, right? So this is the motivation why we use optical techniques. So the technique that I use in my lab is called optical coherence tomography, and some of you may have heard of it. It's this year it's turning up actually 25 years old. And what this technique does is it has the resolution of anywhere between half a micron to a few microns. It can penetrate up to about a millimeter and a half to 2 millimeter below the surface of biological tissue. If we image the eye, the laser beam can actually travel the whole 25 millimeter length of the eye and reach the backside of the eye, which is the retina, and that's exactly what is shown here with the yellow light. And the retina is a type of neural tissue that is comprised of multiple layers. So this is a histological image of the retina. You can see the individual cells with the black dots and the connection between the different types of cell in the gray smudges here. This is an in vivo image obtained from the retina of a student of mine. So he still has his eye. We haven't taken it to the lab. This was from a laboratory. It does work. So there is no damage that I know of. We can visualize large blood vessels in the choroid. We can visualize different layers in the retina. And the white spots here are actually reflections from individual red blood cells that are squeezing one by one in individual capillaries. So our technique has the possibility to acquire three-dimensional images. This is 1,000 by 1,000 by 4,000 pixels in depth within less than 10-second time period. And I'll explain later how we do that. But once we get the three-dimensional images, we can slice and dice them in different ways. And in this case, the images are acquired perpendicular, like this, to the retina, and then we can slice them in parallel way. And if we do that, at the surface we see the nerve fibers, the resolution is high enough. And if we slice deeper, we actually see that those white dots in the previous slide connect and make up the capillaries in a certain layer within the retina. This is the optic nerve head with the large blood vessels positioned there. So the same device, but imagine it a different imaging probe, can image the front part of the eye here, which is called the cornea, transparent tissue in front of your pupil. This is a high-resolution image obtained with about a little bit less than two micron resolution in vertical direction in biological tissue. So the cornea itself is about a half a millimeter thick, and it has five distinct layers. The thinnest one here is about 3 to 4 micron, the size of a nuclei. So with the images here, we can recognize that layer, and we can also see reflections from individual cells. Now, the research that I conduct is multidisciplinary, so we have both clinical collaborators, but we also collaborate with the Vision Image Processing Group at System Design Engineering Department. So with their help, we developed automatic algorithms to automatically segment and identify layers in biological tissue, identify and count cells, and we can use those parameters as markers that can be used later on for diagnosing a disease. The image here is showing the case where we have a system with the lung scanning range, and this is a cross-sectional image of the human cornea of a patient that has gone through a corneal replacement surgery. So this part of the cornea here has been replaced with a donor one, and here you're seeing this white loop here is the suture. So if you combine cross-sectional images like this, we can get a three-dimensional view of the cornea, and the yellow dots here represent exactly where the sutures are. So we can monitor the healing of the tissue. This image here is from another surgical procedure called intact rings, and is used in keratoconic subjects to flatten the cornea, because keratoconus causes the cornea to turn from a spherical surface to almost elliptical one. And if any of you remember your optics classes, you know that elliptical mirrors can give you double foci, fossae, right? So you will have double vision. And this is a three-dimensional image of the intact ring, which is a semicircle of a plastic material. We can identify other things in tissue, ocular tissue, like nerve fiber bundles. And this is an interesting project. We were the first group to image glands in the eyelid that produce oil that mixes with the tear film. And the reason why nature designed those glands and the oil production is to slow down the evaporation of the water of the tear film. So this would allow you to keep your eyes open for 10 seconds without blinking, right? So it's very clever. So the normal glands look like this, and those are on-fast slices from three dimensions. And this is a gland from one subject which was inflamed, so it pops up pretty much like a big mushroom, and it has remnants of cells, it has white cells there, and calcifications. Other applications of this technology range from dermatology, where you can image the skin. Those are a little bit older images, and they're more impressive ones that are available right now, both from other research groups and commercial devices. The only thing that is changing is the wavelength range at which the source is operating, how deep you want to penetrate within tissue, and what kind of resolution you want to sustain, and of course, the imaging probes. This is another project that showcases a different application of the technology where we can image brain tumors. Typically, during neurosurgery, you don't have the time to get a biopsy and then do the normal stained histology. And even cryohistology takes about half an hour. So with our high-resolution system, we can recognize the enlarged nuclei of cancer cells, and we can differentiate between healthy gray matter and different types of tumor. This is fibrous meningioma, and this is two different types of gangliogliomas. And we can see that the structural differences in the tumors allow us to differentiate between different types of tumors. Because of the high resolution, we can even image single cells. In this project, what we've done is we used glial cells in a petri dish. This is a non-fast view with a regular phase sensitive microscope, and those are the cross-sectional OCT images. We see that this particular cell, for example, was in the process of division, and the same cell here, we have a cross-sectional view of it. So the dark regions are exactly the nucleotides in the divided nuclei, right, that give a very high reflection and appear black on the images. The beauty about this technique is not only that it can provide very fast, three-dimensional, non-invasive images of biological tissue, but it can do so much more. For example, most of you, or if all of you, are aware of Doppler effect, right? You send a wave to a stationary object, it comes back with the same frequency. You send a wave to a moving plane, it comes back at a different frequency. So if you're looking at the blood vessel where the blood is flowing, interaction of photons with the moving red blood cells is going to give a different frequency of the interference signal here. So this allows us to take the amplitude of the signal and create a morphological image, and then do a Fourier transform operation on the fringe pattern, look at the phase information, changes there, and we can identify regions in the tissue where there is movement, and we can identify direction of the blood flow, we can even identify the profile of the blood flow and quantify the total flow that is flowing for a particular amount of time. Doing so, we can characterize vascularization in particular tissue, and what you're looking up here is the optic nerve head of the retina in the back of the eye. This is where all the optical nerves actually duck down and then connect to the backside of the brain where you have the visual cortex. In addition to that, again, if we take the amplitude, that creates a structural image. But if we do a Fourier transform on the fringe pattern, at every single location, we can create a spectrum. So then, from the surface here to somewhere deep in the imaged object, we can follow up how that spectrum changes depending on what the material does in terms of absorbing or scattering the light for a particular wavelength. And by comparing the spectra, we can do spectroscopic analysis. One easy way is to recolor your tomogram with the spectroscopic information, which makes visualization of small details here much better. But then you can also go to quantitative analysis and determine, for example, glucose level in the blood, or oxygen level in the blood, or content of melanin in the skin, when, especially in skin cancers. How do we achieve the high resolution? The resolution is tied up to how much bandwidth we can get from a light source and how much bandwidth we can propagate through the optical system up to the detector so it gets detected. This is a fairly old slide, but it does a very good job in terms of summarizing the different types of lasers that we use in our research. We have supercontinuum generation from photonic crystal fibers. We have femtolasers that are high power, high frequency lasers. There are superluminescent diodes, and the spectral ranges we can access with our imaging systems that will give us different penetration in tissue can span anywhere between 400 nanometer up to about 1600 nanometer. That also covers different chromophores, so we can do imaging, we can do blood flow, and we can do spectral analysis. What my group is renowned internationally is also the possibility to look at functional response of neural tissue. For example, you have a patient in the dark, flashlight at the retina, and the retinal neurons are going to get activated. Currently, there are only electrical methods to detect that activation. What we are working on in the lab is an optical, completely non-invasive method to do so. In terms of how do we detect the light and how fast we detect the light, we do need two different devices at the detector end of the system. We need a spectrometer and we need a camera. The spectrometer is going to spread the light over a certain number of numbers of the pixels of the camera, and it's going to be responsible to the length of the imaging frame. And the camera is going to determine how fast we acquire the images. And these are just an example of manufacturers that have developed some of the best systems that I know of on the market related to OCT applications. And I'm really, really fortunate that two of the companies are actually located in Waterloo. I've been collaborating with PMP Optica for the past 9 years, and we have a line of different spectrometers designed for different spectral ranges, and Ola is going to probably mention this in her presentation. And we also have Teledyne DALSA in town, and we've been testing different cameras that are exactly suitable for OCT with the intent of eventually developing a camera that is specifically targeted to high-speed, high-resolution OCT applications. Where we are heading, where we are and where we are heading, there is quite a bit of room for development for technology. We can do different things with this particular method. There are different medical applications, and there are also clinical tests that are happening. Application in ophthalmology date pretty much 25 years. Dermatology is only the last 5 years where we have companies and research groups developing systems consistently. Vascularization and intra-arterial imaging has been going on research-wise for the past 10 to 15 years. It's a difficult problem, but that's the point where it can be studied clinically at the moment. I know that most of you come from companies, and I wanted to give you an overview where the market is at the moment. This is the avalanche effect of established companies developing line of production of OCT system, and also new companies that are forming. And I'd like to thank the many talented students that I worked with over the past 10 years while I was here at the university, and the funding provided by different funding agencies, and in-kind contribution from collaborators. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bisheva. That's a great, very detailed presentation.